This Sunday, the gospel is the gospel we're all familiar with, the man born blind. The couple of times I had the blessing of this gospel, I always thought that we really need to take it over a couple of months. There's so much here, there's so much in how what Christ is doing, what the man is doing, how the gospel of today relates to the gospel of St. John's in general. But this morning I wanted to just very briefly touch again on two small points. One of the big issues with this gospel is the issue of meaning. I'm sure a couple of you are tired of hearing me talk about that over and over again, but meaning, the meaning of suffering. This is a man who was born blind, who lived his entire life in blindness. Not his childhood, not his adolescence. He's a full-grown man, and he's never known light. He was reduced to becoming a beggar, completely dependent on the charity of others simply to survive. When people walked by him, they had compassion on him, they gave him money, they helped him in various ways, but in the back of their minds, they're thinking, I'm really glad that's not me. In the eyes of the world, this man, his story, his state, his condition, what he is reduced to is a tragedy in every way. But as we look at the gospel through God's eyes, we see that what is a tragedy in the eyes of humans, of the tragedy of our eyes, is a blessing to him. He is selected, he is set aside for a very special purpose. People are trying to find meaning to this man's condition. It's a very old, old question. Why is there suffering? Why is this man in this deplorable condition? Is it his fault? Is it his parents' fault? Whose fault it is that this man is not right, that he is suffering? Here in this gospel, it's important to see that the question comes from the disciples. The initial question comes from the disciples. It does not come from the Pharisees. This is not intended to be a test for Christ. As over and over again, the Pharisees tested him to see how he would answer. This is a question coming from inside, from his very group of followers. They too are wondering, just like we in the church often wonder, why is there this suffering? Who sinned? Is it this man? Is it his parents? There must be a cause. What is the cause of this man's suffering? This is not a new question. This is a question that this man has been plagued with his whole life. This is a question that his parents have been plagued with their whole life. What did we do? Is it something that we did that affected our child in this way? Meaning in adversity, meaning in suffering, is one of the most important themes and messages of this gospel. And the answer that we get is remarkable, and it's distinctly different from the answers that we get from the world, from society, from all other religions. Across the globe, in half of the religions of the world, the question would be wrong in itself. Why is there suffering? Their answer is, well, the question is wrong. There's always suffering. Mere existence is suffering. There is no suffering. There's no existence other than suffering. The book of Job, when you look at the book of Job, as long as it is, it's over and over again. Job trying to understand, why is he suffering? Those around him trying to understand, why is he suffering? In this case, the man's suffering is due to our benefit. It is for the glory of God. He has been set aside his whole life for the purpose of manifesting God's glory and God's love and majesty. It's crucial when you look at verse 32, verse 32, the man himself, after the miracle, he himself states that never since the world began has it been heard of that anyone opened the eyes of someone who was born blind. It is crucial that these words, this revelation, comes at the mouth of the man who was born blind. His entire life, he has been looking for the answer. Why am I suffering? Was it me? Was it my parents? Why? And finally, he understands that he has been set aside, that he has been given a special glory. Never since the world began has anyone heard of someone opening the eyes of someone born blind. His whole life has led to that realization. At times, as we go through our own tribulations, our troubles, sometimes the answers don't come quickly. At times, we battle with God. God, why do you allow this or that to happen? Why did you allow me to enter this temptation or into this obstacle? And it can be anything. It could be a huge spectrum of things, from the trivial, and of course, if it's happening to you, it's not that trivial. But from what may be considered trivial to huge life-altering changes, sometimes we ask God, why is there suffering? Why did you allow this to happen? And the answer does not come on our timetable. It's at those times that we need faith. It's at that time that we need perseverance. First, we have to make sure that suffering is not because of us. Because we being human, we are masters at creating our own suffering and then blaming God for it. We do that over and over again. So the first step, the very basic step as well, is what is happening due to me? Is it something that I have done? Or is it something that God is leading me through? But if we eliminate ourselves, then we have to, and we are going through tribulation, we're going through a trial, we have to think about that man born blind, that the answer will come. It may not be in our timetable, not be at the end of our prayer at night when we're telling God, well, I really need an answer now. But the answer will come. And if we are honest with ourselves and we are honest with God, he will reveal that answer to us. The man who was viewed as being a curse unto his family, unto his very self, in God's eyes was set aside for a special purpose, so that he now not only gains the blessing of that glorious miracle, that unique miracle, but that he now, through his testimony, may lead others, through his example, may lead others to God. When we look at the gospel of this morning, the gospel of this morning has long been associated with illumination, with the sacrament of illumination, baptism, within our church. Now, any day is a good day for baptism. But historically in the church, there's a couple of occasions that really stood out as kind of prime times to become baptized. And it fluctuated over time from region to region, from century to century. At one point, especially in Jerusalem, the high point was during Easter, the Easter service, or right before the Easter service. There's some evidence in our church that not only is this gospel associated with baptism because of the washing of the man, which we'll get into in a minute, but that also at a certain point in our history, this was the Sunday in which many would bring their children to be baptized. The association with baptism is very clear, very clear. The man is born blind. He washes in a pool called the Sent, the one who is sent. Who is the one who is sent to liberate? Who is the one who is sent to take away the sins of the world? Christ. He is blind. He is sent to wash in the pool. pool of the one who is sent, and hence he is illuminated. His eyes return to him. He can see again. He literally has light in his eyes. And it's no accident that "I am the light of the world" comes right at the beginning of this miracle. In the old world, in the ancient world, in the medieval world, they had this idea about how we see things. Now, by our standards, it's going to seem a little quirky and naive, but in their world, they believe that when you see something, it's really a meeting of two lights. That whatever you're seeing emits light, and that from your eyes, there is other light that is coming through, and as those two lights intersect, you see. This is why you find kind of the old Arabic saying, and I think it's much older than the Arab conquest, but you know, somebody's the light of my eyes. It's not the vision of my eyes, it's they literally believe that there's light that comes out of your eyes, and that is how you're able to see. Those two components are still important today for sight. What is outside and what is inside. We live in a world in which most people are gifted with sight. Blindness exists, but it's not prevalent. Most individuals we meet are sighted. But we live still in a world that is blind. The true light that enlightens every man that comes into the world has already come 2,000 years ago, but so many individuals walk around with their eyes closed. That light is there, but they refuse to see it. That light in their eyes is still not there. Throughout this gospel, the association is quite important between blindness, darkness, sin, sight, illumination, and righteousness. It is no sin to be blind, and that's not really what the gospel is speaking about. He's speaking about blindness as in sinfulness. And if you look at the very end of the gospel, that is very clear. There's so many verses that come to mind where this notion comes up over and over again. Most importantly, in Titus 3. He saved us through the washing of the regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Spirit. This notion of washing, that the man goes blind, he washes, he becomes illuminated. That is at the core of the sacrament of baptism. That is the core of the Christian life. But we have to be clear that illumination is not mere sight. The Pharisees, all of the Pharisees engaged in the gospel of this morning, all of them had their vision. All of them could see. Some of them, I imagine, might have passed this man and given him alms over the times. But when you look at the gospel, they are the ones who are truly blind. When you look at the man, the gospel repeatedly refers to him as the man who formerly was blind, the man who had been blind. But when you look at the gospel carefully, it is the Pharisees, those with their eyesight intact, who are the most blind, over and over again. They go from, "This man is not from God. We know that this man is a sinner." Well, how do you know? Because he did something good. He did something good on the Sabbath, so that's how you know that he is a sinner. Obstinate, stubborn, stuck in their darkness, in their spiritual darkness. As for the man, you kind of see the progression of his miracle, his illumination. On one hand, the physical, on one hand, the spiritual. The physical is clear enough. He goes from not seeing anything to seeing like everyone else. But gradually, he begins to understand. When he's first asked, "Who does this miracle to you?" he just simply says, "The man Jesus." A little bit later, he says, "Well, it's the prophet who did this to me, is a prophet Jesus." And at the end of the gospel, as the Lord goes to him, and asked him, do you believe in the Son of Man? The man answers, yes, Lord, I believe, and he bows down and worships him. Illumination is not just simply sight. The easy part of this miracle is the man regaining his sight. But as the Pharisees are getting deeper and deeper into darkness, they're adding to their ignorance, darkness, and sin. The man at every step is seeing better. He's understanding better. He is comprehending. He is comprehending at a deeper level. Even in how he describes Christ, he goes from simply mentioning that he can't be a sinner because he is from God. Then later on in the gospel, right about verse 31. I'm sorry, the copy I have here does not have the verse numbers. He gives a very simple answer at the beginning, but then towards the end of the gospel, not only is he understanding who Christ is better, but he becomes something of a theologian. Look at what he says to the Pharisees. Why, this is a marvelous thing, that you do not know where he is from, and yet he has opened my eyes. Now, he starts turning into a theologian. Now, we know that God does not hear sinners, but if anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, he hears him. Since the world began, it has been unheard of that anyone opened the eyes of one who was born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. This illumination, this miracle, is not just simply a miracle of his sight. It's a miracle of his understanding. It's a miracle of the depth of his understanding. At every step, at every interrogation, not only does he understand Christ more clearly, but he goes from being a simple beggar who is undoubtedly illiterate to providing a theological rationale that the Pharisees themselves can't argue against. Right after this, they just simply get frustrated with him and kick him out. They get angry with him. He presents a logical, theological defense. They can't respond. The easiest thing is, well, kick him out. They end the conversation that way. In many ways in our lives, we need to look at challenges, obstacles, things that come our way in a manner similar to this man and his interrogation. Over and over again, he is brought back before the Pharisees. That's not fun. He's being interrogated. He's being questioned. There are real penalties at stake. But each time he goes before that trial, he comes back with a deeper understanding of Christ, not only for himself, but for others. We have to look at the struggles in our lives, be great or small, in that light, not only of the man who finds meaning to his suffering at the very end, but the man who at every step, at every stage, at every temptation, at every tribulation, he gains a deeper understanding of Christ for himself and for others. Baptism in the early church and this gospel in the early church are quite important. It is this calling out of darkness into light, and that comes up repeatedly in the scriptures with St. Peter, with St. Paul. The calling of Christ to St. Peter, to St. Paul. He tells them, I am sending you to open their eyes. This is in Acts 26. I am sending you to open their eyes so that they may turn from darkness. We turn from darkness to light. This was a major point of transition in anyone's life. In the modern world, we have something of a, I don't want to call it a mixed blessing, but it's a blessing that has an unintended consequence. In the modern world, and not just today, but since the beginning of Christianity, many of us are many of our children are baptized as infants. They never quite heard that calling as adults, this calling to leave darkness and go into light. Now, this is on solid theological grounds. So this is, we're not talking about child baptism today or infant baptism. That's not really the issue. The issue is the unintended consequence. That for so many of us and so many of our children, they grow up in the church not really realizing this inheritance that has been given to them. Kind of like spoiled children who've never been at a need for money. Their parents have always showered them for money, so they never quite understand the value of money. This is the undesirable effect. Now, there's been a couple of solutions. The Catholics, our brothers, the Catholics, they've decided, okay, we'll have baptism for infants, but we'll delay communion, which is an imperfect solution. But the Protestants, they said, we're going to delay both of them, which is an awful solution. The problem is not infant baptism. The problem is this unintended consequence where children grow up and they become adults who grow up kind of taking church and God and all of this for granted. You don't understand this calling from darkness into light. They never had that experience, like the man born blind here, who for his entire life he is surrounded by darkness, and then bam, in one moment, in one instant, he sees light, fundamentally altering his life. For many of us in the church, we need a second illumination, a second illumination and baptism. And the pattern is quite clear in the scriptures. You can find it in this gospel, you can find it in the New Testament, you find it in all the lives of the saints. The first step always starts with an encounter with Christ. Notice in this gospel, in this miracle, Christ does everything. The man is just sitting there begging as he has done for decades beforehand. Christ goes to him, he engages him, he heals him. All that the man had to do was simply to obey. That simple act that oftentimes we find as a Herculean task, obeying what the Lord said. He obeyed, and because of his obedience, he comes up with this irrefutable, most powerful declaration that he has. Where at one point in his interrogation, if you recall, he gets kind of fed up with all the questions of the Pharisees, and he simply tells them, there's one thing I know, I was blind and now I see. And that you can't really get around. The first step is that honest encounter with Christ. The second and the third kind of come together, hand in hand. One is discipleship, following through this basic pattern of obedience. When he told the man, go and wash, the man washed. He took faith and he went and washed. Now, you have to imagine how silly he looked. This blind beggar that everybody is familiar with, going around with mud on his face, telling people, where is this pool of water? Well, he follows through to the point where later on in the gospel of this morning, the Pharisees accuse him of being a disciple. You're a disciple of that man, but we are disciples of Moses. With discipleship, with following the path of God, there is always tribulation. The man was repeatedly accosted. He was repeatedly brought into before the Pharisees for something that resembles a trial. At the very end, he is kicked out. And it is really no different for our lives. Following the word of Christ, that discipleship brings with it tribulation. Now, whether you're looking at the life of St. Paul, the life of St. Anthony, the life of any saint, you're going to find these three basic steps, that encounter, that initial encounter with God, that not just coming in to church or in the morning saying Our Father, but that honest, sincere encounter with Christ, followed by that discipleship and that tribulation. The tribulation is, as we mentioned with this, with the man born blind, at every point, every tribulation, every trial, he gains understanding, he gains knowledge. These are not tribulations and sufferings and trials just for nothing. It's not just simply a test, because sometimes we imagine that these things happen to us because God is up there on his throne just kind of amusing himself. Are they going to pass this test or not? How well are they going to pass this one? It's not about that. At every test, at every turn, he gains a spiritual benefit. He gains a blessing. His understanding and his life changes. The encounter with Christ, the discipleship, the tribulation lead to a fourth step, the victory in Christ. And again, whether you're looking at the Old Testament, the New Testament, the lives of your favorite saint, it's that encounter, the discipleship, the tribulation, and that vindication, that victory in Christ. Christ does not let those who fight in his name go astray. The man, after he was kicked out of the synagogue, Christ himself went to him. It is Christ who, again, who the one who sought him out at the beginning, is the one who seeks him out at the end. It is he who seeks him out. It is he who consoles him. It is he who changes the man. The man goes from gaining mere sight, his vision, to having his mind illuminated, to meeting the true light that enlightens every man who comes into the world. This morning, may God grant us the grace so that we too, like that man, may return from the washing. And not just with mud off of our faces, but with illumination. That our minds go from mere sight, from mere seeing, to apprehending and meeting the true light who comes into the world. And let us pray for a second illumination. Glory be to God.